And then in the same little mazurka, after contrasting sections, reprises, after it's all over, Chopin gives the final ambiguous twist in the very last bars, where he again has arrived at A minor. We're absolutely sure it's A minor. Isn't that convincingly A minor? And then come the very last bars, which are exactly like the first bars. That's the end of the piece. What key are we in? Sort of F? Lydian mode? Well, certainly not A minor. We're left hovering, as we began, in a bliss of ambiguities. And they're all ambiguities born of intrinsic musical metaphors. You see, the meanings, as we discovered last week, belong to purely musical semantics. Meanings all derived from a combination of phonological and syntactic transformations. Now, I've been speaking of ambiguity as an aesthetic function, and this may seem to carry the implication that the more ambiguous music gets, the more expressive it becomes. Okay, but does that mean, for instance, that chromaticism is better than diatonic plain talk? Does it represent an advance in musical progress? Many people ask me that all the time. Is Chopin better than Mozart because he's more chromatic than Mozart? If so, then shouldn't Bartok be better than Beethoven? And the Beatles better than Bessie Smith? Is Keats more chromatic than Shakespeare? And Swinburne more than Keats, and therefore better than Keats?